Good evening, everyone. This is Dr. Ruta Kulkarni, President, Assami India. I welcome you all for this masterclass on a very important topic of lengthening over nail. Limb lengthening really has come a long way from pure Elizarro to self-lengthening nails. And on this path, lengthening over nail is a very, very important landmark. So those who want to go for limb lengthening or who are already doing limb lengthening, they must learn this fantastic technique of lengthening over nail because it reduces the fixator period to great extent. So to talk about this lengthening over nail, we have very good faculty today. I welcome all the faculty members. And today's masterclass is organized by our joint secretary, Dr. Jayant Sharma, sir. So I hand over the meeting to him. But before that, Dr. Ravi Chauhan, Secretary Assami India, if you want to make any comments, you can. Otherwise, Dr. Sharma, sir, over to you.
Yeah, ma'am.
Jayant, sir, please start.
Okay. I'll want to share the screen. Is it visible?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So, good evening, everybody. This topic is very close to all the faculty members over here. Lengthening over nail, as Ruta ma'am has said, is a very upcoming and demanding topic in today's scenario. The faculty of today's masterclass includes Professor Ruta M. Kulkarni ma'am. She is President of Assami India and ex-Vice President of Assami. She is Professor of Orthopedics and Head of Pediatric Orthopedics at Swasthi Yog Pratishthan, Meerut. She has been faculty in various Elizarro courses in India and abroad since last 20 years. She has many publications in international and journals like Indian Journal of Orthopedics. She has been a faculty in pediatric orthopedic conferences, her field of interest being deformity correction and lengthening. The next speaker is Dr. Milind Chaudhary. He is MS Ortho and a pioneer in field of Elizarro technique in India. He is Editor-in-Chief of Limb Lengthening and Reconstruction. It is official journal of ILLRS, Assami BR, and now also of Assami India. He has presented 100 of scientific papers in regional, state, and national conferences. He has participated in training workshops as faculty in Canada, USA, Russia, England, Egypt, etc. Awards and honors. He has received Professor of Elizarro, Honored Professor of Elizarro Center Award conferred by Kurgan, Veterans Surgeons Award from Bombay Orthopedic Society, Young Surgeon Forum Award from Bombay Orthopedic Society, and a Rotary Gold Medal. Apart from that, he has won Gold Medal, KP Srivastav Gold Medal for Best Poster in IOCON, and also Masala Wala Best Paper in VIROC. He was President of Assami India from 2009 to 13, and he's one of the members of Assami Joint Congress in Brisbane. The next speaker is Professor Dr. Vasudevan. He is currently working as head of Thangam Institute of Orthopedic Surgery, Trauma and Elizarro, Palakkad, Kerala. He completed his MBBS and DOT from Calicut, and after that MS from Kilpok Medical College. He got his Diplomat of National Board and membership of NAMS. Before his MS, he is also current president of Kerala Orthopedic Association. He has received prestigious Professor K.V. Sundaran Memorial Gold Medal, Best Paper Award for Orthocon in 96, Gold Medal for Best Poster at Annual Meeting of Kerala Orthopedic Society, and Gold Medal of Best Poster in Tamil Nadu Orthopedic Association, Gold Medal for Best Paper in Current Concepts in Trauma in 2014. He has been invited to perform demonstration surgeries of Elizarro technology at Calicut Medical College. He has given an invited lecture on Elizarro Indian experience in 2004 May in Bristol. He delivered Professor P.A. Alexander Memorial Oration in Arthrocon held at Calicut and delivered Silver Jubilee Oration of KOA in 2013. His publication on Trendelenburg sign can be positive with normal hip is published in JBJS in 1997. In Journal of Kerala Orthopedic, he has his publications on non-unions and fingertip injuries. The next speaker is Professor P.N.V.S.V. Prasad from Srijan Ortho Accident Care, Khammam, Telangana. He's a well-known figure in Andhra and Telangana and called as Ror Pele of that area. That was told in one of the webinars. He did his MBBS in 1982 from Warangal, then did his DOR from Belgaum. In 1990, started Srajan Ortho and Accident Care at Khammam. 1997, he was trained at Kurgan. In 2004, he went to Italy, Lecco, under Professor Catani. In 2006, Baltimore Limb Deformity Course, he was observer in Sinai Hospital, Baltimore. In 2008, observer under Professor Kamil Ahmed Husni at Egypt, Cairo, Egypt. He was ex-executive member of Asami India. At present, he is one of the faculties of Asami India. The next slide. Yeah. The youngest of the speakers is Dr. Prashant Upadhyay, the assistant professor at Amaldas Medical College. After doing his MBBS from Agra, he did his DNV in orthopedics. He is a complex trauma deformity correction surgeon at Greater Kailash Hospital, Indore. And he is a visiting surgeon in Index Medical College. His academics is very much appreciable. And he has been award winner, gold medal for in quizzes till in his postgraduate period. And won his best paper award in 2019, just recently. Is associate editor of Indian Journal of Orthopedic Surgery. So that was about the faculty members. And coming on to the first lecture, I think so it should be me to do the opening batsmanship. Although never been an opening batsman in cricketing days, I'll be speaking on history, indication and assessment of limb-length discrepancies. I'm professor at Index Medical College, joint secretary Asami India and editor-in-chief
Jan,
of...
Sir.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. You have not shared your PPT yet.
Okay. Sorry. I'll do the sharing. Share screen. Yeah.
Good evening, all.
Good evening, Vasudevan.
Yeah.
I already introduced you.
Yeah, thank you.
So I'll start with the history assessment and indication part of limb lengthening.
Jayan sir, can you start with the first slide?
Okay, yeah.
Please.
So it would be history, indication and assessment of limb lengthening. I mean, basically limb deformities, discrepancies. I am a professor at Index Medical College and joint secretary Asami India, editor-in-chief in Indian Journal of Orthopedic Surgery. The pelvis needs to be horizontal and the lumbar spine symmetrical for bipedal loading and in the stance phase during the gait. Leg length inequality is one of the correctable risk factors for knee osteoarthritis. Hence, acquired or congenital disparity ought to be restored through historic two. Although the historic 2 cm rule of accepting the limb length discrepancy is more of an enigma than a science, because considering the anatomic parameters like pelvic width, absolute leg length, muscle force and proprioceptive capacity should be considered even if there is a limb length discrepancy of smallest of 2 cm. Every limb length discrepancy should be equalized by conservative means like insoles, prosthesis, orthosis. Their long-term acceptance is low in regard to function, cost, expenditure and appearance. Timely epiphyseodesis is best option in uniplanar deformity, with adequate remaining growth and for patients whose predicted final outcome is about 50th percentile, below which it is not a very useful surgery. However, many patients present late or with multiplanar deformities, which warrant more sophisticated operative approach. Recent development in deformity corrections allows for patient and surgeon-friendly web-based restoration of any three-dimensional deformity correction. Still, there are biological limitations and challenges. The patient and his psychological, medico-economic, logistic, and legal environment should be considered. He should be consented and educated for the delayed consolidations, pseudoarthrosis, malalignments, joint contracture, dislocations, pain, infection, and prolonged inability to work and refrain from school and sports activities before considering limb lengthening surgeries. The history of surgical bone lengthening comprises of 100 exciting years of struggling, development, and still an ongoing process. The initial strategy of acute or rapid incremental distraction lasted almost half a century until Elizaro recognized the benefits of biological periosteum preserving osteotomies and incremental lengthening at slow rate, that is 1 mm per day, at 4 increments of 0.25 mm with well appreciable callostasis. Due to significant risk of malalignment, indication of lengthening by unilateral fixation has shrunken to moderate amount of disparity and unique to biplanar deformities in patients with open physis. Nowadays, mechanical or motorized minimally invasive nails prevent muscle fixation, therefore ease of rehabilitation, and have taken over the surgical market, I can say, by potentially shortening the overall time of sick leave. So coming on to the historical aspects, first surgical stretching was done by Langenbeck, Codivilla, very famous in orthopedic practice. During a PG times, it was always one of the scientists whose name was there in the review of literatures. He performed femoral osteotomy in patient with coxa vara and gave a transcalcaneal traction up to 25 to 75 kgs. Ombardane in 1930 was the first person to start gradual distraction by 5 mm per day using lengthening on a femur. Vittorio Putti did a Z-shaped osteotomy but a slower distraction rate and achieved up to 8 cm lengthening. The first to recognize the importance of delaying in lengthening after osteotomy was August Bayer, who reported on femoral lengthening in 1923, but he failed since he cut the periosteum, and this delayed the periosteal sleeve development. A broad array of biological and hardware trials and errors over time, like fascia resection, soft tissue resection, stirrup-shaped irons, have manifold frustrations, obstacles, and challenges in history of bone lengthening. Wittmoser's first ring fixator was devised by him, but a decisive methodological and hardware refinement was a genius of single-man pioneering effort, that is Gavril Abramovich Elizaro. Unaware of Elizaro's progress, unilateral fixation and fast lengthening was done by Wagner, but he did cut the periosteum followed by bone grafting and plate osteosynthesis. In modern web-based hexapod platform technology, Taylor spatial frames, ortho SUVs, and fully implantable solid intramedullary nail has more predictable and comfortable outcome. So coming on to what is there in this procedure, this is divided in two phases. One is a distraction phase and the other one is a consolidation phase. During the distraction phase, the limb is lengthened. After the desired lengthening is achieved, consolidation phase begins. This phase ends when the newly formed bone within the distraction gap has sufficiently healed. The consolidation phase is usually 2 times longer in children than the distraction phase in children. In adults, it is 3 to 4 times longer. So the challenge for orthopedic surgeon nowadays is to reduce this consolidation period, and then because of this only, lengthening over nail was devised and started. The indication of lengthening is for polio, growth arrest caused by osteomyelitis, chondrometaphyseal dysplasias, posteromedial bowing of tibia, constitutional short stitches following scoliosis, cerebral palsy, and hip dysplasia. This is an important thing which I got to know while going through the literature, that if you're in a hip dysplasia secondary to septic arthritis and where Elizaro hip reconstruction has been done, tibia can be lengthened over a nail instead of doing it in a femur. The shortening can be compensated by lengthening the tibia. The mechanical excess is already corrected by femur. The lengthening part could be taken up in the tibia also. So for selecting a patient for lengthening over nail, segment chosen where there is no significant deformity, but it could be correctable also. The amount of lengthening achieved is average 4.6 centimeters, and the lengthening range from 4 to 31 centimeters means 14.8% of the initial segment. So again, a lot of work was done by Drawer, Pele and Hasenberg, and they devised a difficulty level assessment scale before planning for a limb lengthening procedure. The scale was based on 11 parameters that increase the difficulty, risk, and tibial lengthening that included age, complexity of deformity, other levels of treatment, associated lengthening, joint instability, fixed deformities in the knee, ankle, quality of the bone, and quality of soft tissue. This is how they formed a chart, 0 point, 1 point, 2, and 3 point. On basis of this, if the deformity of the patient is considered having mild problems, if the points are less than 6, moderate from 7 to 11, and severe for more than 12 points. So those patients who came into severe were rarely treated by lengthening of a nail or for lengthening procedures. The moderate one were first treated for the deformities and then they were shifted on to the lengthening procedure. So these are some theoretical aspect method of using assessing leg length difference by the tape measure. But the problem with the tape measure is it's going only up to the ankle joint. So any deformity of the foot will never be considered. So it is always better to do a standing block measurement in which the block will also measure the difference of height as well as the foot and ankle deformity. The radiological assessment involves a scanogram. The patient lays supine on the wooden grid with sandbag and feet and strap across the thighs. Here, the positioning of both the patellate should be towards the ceiling. That is most important, and the tube should be at 110 centimeters. Whenever you are writing for a scanogram, these two points have to be told to be the radiographer. The three separate x-rays are taken at the hip, knee and ankle joint and then stitched together. And nowadays, it is CT-guided, nicely done by that. A telorhoangiogram is a full-length standing AP radiograph of lower limb. It consists of a single radiograph. Here, the limb length discrepancy can be assessed by placing a block under the under the feet. The third one is an orthorhoangiogram. This is the best one because it takes a single film. There is minimum magnification and it also involves contribution of foot deformity and determining the level of pelvis, femur and tibial length. Now coming on to what, how will you say your result was good or bad or poor? So there's an evaluation criteria post lengthening, a tibial lengthening outcome score with that is called, on clinical and radiographic criteria. In this, there are two points. One is the adding point and subtracting point. The ankle ROM, lengthening, gait and MPTA are adding points and pain, activity or workability are subtracting values. So, an excellent score is if your points are between 95 to 100. A good score is a total of 75 to 94. A fair is 40 to 74 and a poor score less than 40. This would be of a help for those guys who are wanting to do a thesis or a research on lengthening over nail. This criteria goes like this. If excellent, within 1 centimeter of the goal, if you have achieved the length, there is no problem in the gait and the MPTA is between 85 to 91, it is an excellent consideration. If there is a pain or difficulty in activity, then you subtract from this the amount of points you get over here. So, final result is 95 to 100, good 75 to 94, fair is 40 to 70 and poor is less than 40. A lot of reading was done from these two articles and I thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you, sir, for such a nice presentation.
Yeah, it was really helpful for PGs and young orthopods especially.
Yeah, definitely, ma'am. And are there any questions from the panel?
It's an elaborate introduction. Good. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
So we can move to the next lecture then.
Yes, I think so.
Meanwhile, I'll give a call to Milind sir.
Yeah, I have just spoken to his assistant, sir. So, yeah. Sir is joining within 20 minutes, I think.
Okay.
So, by that time, we can finish.
After madam's case, we can have one case discussion and then we can go in for his lecture.
By the time we can finish ma'am lecture, then we can move into that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or we can also do that if ma'am, we can do also do a one case discussion between that if you want.
So just now you want to go for case discussion or?
If you want to go to, if you want to go early ma'am, then we can just complete your lecture.
Yeah. So right now I'll go for the lecture. Yeah,
sure. Sure.
Okay. So I'll start sharing my screen. Okay, it's visible.
Yeah, ma'am. Please go ahead.
All right. So I'm going to talk about complications of limb lengthening over nail. Actually, the technique of limb lengthening over nail was going to be a lecture before me, but nevertheless, we will go for the complications first. It's very, very important to know all the possible complications of limb lengthening before we go for it, so that we try to avoid them, recognize them early, try to prevent them and treat them properly. So important to know all the complications. Actually, the complications of limb lengthening is a huge topic. It's a very, very big topic. But today I'm going to talk about very few common complications. Actually, I'm going to talk about complications of lengthening in general, but with emphasis on technique of lengthening over nail. So as we know, the surgery of limb lengthening does not end when the patient comes out of operation theater. It continues till the apparatus is removed and even after that. So complications basically can be divided into various phases: intraoperative, distraction phase, consolidation phase, and even after fixator removal. Dror Pelle has given this useful classification. He divides complications into basically three types. A problem is a complication which is fully resolved by non-operative method. An obstacle also is fully resolved, but it needs surgical treatment. And a true complication, actually, it remains unresolved at the end of treatment. So coming to the intraoperative complications, they can be systemic due to anesthesia or comorbidities and local complications. The commonest complication, or you can say a problem, is traumatic corticotomy. Because this traumatic corticotomy leads to many further complications like delayed union and all those things. So one should try to avoid traumatic corticotomy and keep the corticotomy as atraumatic as possible. Unstable frame, again, is a very common intraoperative mistake. Failure to tension the wires properly, failure to pass the wires at proper angle, and leading to unstable frame. Because again, unstable frame leads to multiple complications like, again, loosening of wires, infection, delayed union, and all those things. So this is also a very common problem or mistake that we do. Nerve injury and vascular injury leading to pseudoaneurysm can occur intraoperatively. Nerve injury to common peroneal nerve is more common than you and me think it is. So utmost care should be taken to avoid the nerve injury. Now, coming to this technique of lengthening over nail, improper placement of wires or shanty pins is a big, big hurdle in getting good results. I will elaborate this in detail. Then if you are passing a nail and if you are reaming, then all of us are aware of complications of reaming. They can be there with this technique. And this surgery is a long surgery. It has a long operative time and even radiations are quite a lot. So if you're doing a femoral lengthening, for example, passing shanty pins in the proximal femur is a difficult thing because you have to take utmost care to keep your pins away from the nail to avoid this complication of intramedullary infection. So at least 2 millimeter distance should be there between the nail and the shanty pins, minimum. And you have to do it under C-arm guidance and be very careful. Since today we are talking about tibia mainly, even in tibia, you have to be careful and be away from the nail. In tibia, your wires are posterior to the nail. This is the tibiofibular wire. So you have to pass it carefully. You have to avoid not only the nail, but the interlocking screws also, proximal screws. You can pass one more wire in the tibia, a transverse wire like this. Then anterior Shanspin, again, you have to be away from the nail and the screws. Coming to the distraction phase, all of you who are doing tibial lengthening must be already aware that muscle contracture or the ankle equinus is the commonest problem in tibial lengthening. So muscle contracture is a very, very common complication. If the muscle contracture is left untreated or if it is missed, it can lead to joint subluxation or dislocation. Actually, this is more common in femoral lengthening than tibial. And of course, very important are pin site complications. Well, why do you get muscle contracture? Muscle doesn't like to lengthen. It lengthens only 20% of the bone. And the tension generated by distraction tends to select a dominant muscle group and it gets spasm and leads to contracture. So the muscle which crosses two joints obviously has more chances of getting muscle contracture. So in tibial lengthening, of course, triceps suri is the muscle which develops contracture. So it can lead to even knee flexion deformity, but the most common deformity is ankle equinus. In femoral lengthening, actually, hamstrings can develop muscle contracture, especially if the patient keeps his knee in flexion position for a prolonged time. So how to avoid muscle contracture and especially ankle equinus? So the principle of tension stress is that you have to keep the muscle under tension for at least 6 hours a day, and that can prevent contracture. So you must take care to keep the knee in extension and ankle in dorsiflexion or at least a neutral position for at least 6 hours a day throughout the distraction period. I really cannot overstress the importance of physiotherapy in limb lengthening. Actually, we should have included a lecture on physiotherapy. We could even do a master class on physiotherapy in limb lengthening and Elizaro in general. Physiotherapy is of tremendous importance. You should do passive stretching of muscles, active exercises, range of motion exercises, use of CPM machine, continuous passive motion machine, and then use of orthoses like DynaSplint. I'll be showing you what is DynaSplint. People have used Botox during distraction period with mixed results. So this is the wrong position of the limb during limb lengthening. See here, the patient has kept the pillow below the knee. So knee has gone in flexion. Ankle is free and it has gone in equinus. So this is the position of ease and usually patients do this mistake. So just remove that pillow from the knee and keep it below the ankle, I see. Or you can apply such two rods to the distal ring and elevate the ankle so that the knee is in extension. And you can tie the shoelaces to this ring so that you keep the ankle in neutral position. So this simple trick actually works very well. So this position should be maintained at least for 6 hours a day. DynaSplint does just that. DynaSplint is nothing but a spring-loaded device. In ankle, what it does is it allows plantar flexion, active plantar flexion, but when left to itself, it brings the foot back in neutral or slight dorsiflexion position. DynaSplint for knee is also available. So this is the DynaSplint. This is the spring-loaded device. So patient can plantar flex, but otherwise it immediately brings the foot in neutral position. The same thing can be achieved by using a tight elastic strap around the shoe or even a rubber strap. So you got the point. The ankle should be kept in neutral position or a little 5-degree dorsiflexion throughout the distraction phase. So what if the contracture develops? Well, we should try all the non-operative methods first to treat it as a problem So what you should do is stop distraction for a few days and just go back by few millimeters, just 2 to 3 millimeters, say half millimeter per day. So if the contracture is mild or it is just a spasm mainly, then it literally melts away with your just few millimeters of shortening. And once that is done, go for vigorous physiotherapy and then start distraction at a slower rate. And this is a small tip or trick you can say that I do. If there is mild knee contracture during tibial leaning, what you can do is incorporate the rings into the plaster across the knee and connect hinges and distraction bar to that. So like that. So if there is knee contracture, mild knee contracture, mild knee flexion position, then you can put 2 threaded rods anteriorly, 2 threaded rods posteriorly, incorporate them in a plaster cast, attach rings to them and attach hinges and distraction bar posteriorly. So disclaimer, I have not published it anywhere, but you can see it's a small trick that I use, which could be useful to you. It works very well. Only thing is that you keep the patient under your observation because the plaster cast can slip. But if the contracture is severe and it is not amenable to conservative treatment, then you have to go for operative treatment. You have to cross the joint and apply fixator across the joint. Sometimes you have to go for tendon lengthening or vulpius release. So extending the fixator to the foot during tibial lengthening is a very useful thing. In long tibial lengthenings, I do that quite commonly. I apply the foot frame during distraction phase only, so to avoid ankle contracture. But see here, the position is perfect. The knee is in extension. If you're doing femoral lengthening, especially if you're doing congenital short femur syndrome like things, then it's a good idea to always extend the frame below the knee to prevent muscle contracture and joint subluxations. So if the contracture is mild and not amenable to conservative, then you can do this vulpius release. Or if it's a severe one, then you will have to go for Z lengthening. Coming to next complication of joint dislocation or subluxation. If muscle contracture is left untreated, it leads to subluxation. That happens more commonly in femoral lengthening. Like I told you, hamstring can go into contracture and pull the tibia back. But don't be under the impression that only knee subluxates. There can be subluxation or dislocation of hips also. Especially, as I told you, in congenital short femur syndromes, this was a case of congenital short femur syndrome. It was being lengthened with orthofix and see what has happened to the hip. So you should always anticipate such complications. And if the hip is unstable, you should do prophylactic surgeries before you go for limb lengthenings. So the prophylaxis is same as muscle contracture, physiotherapy and keeping 6 hours knee position and all those things. And as I told you, if the joint is unstable, prophylactic surgery should be done. If you have removed the fixator and if you notice joint subluxations or dislocations, then span the fixator. Again, you might have to reapply the fixator or go for tendon lengthenings or even capsular releases. This is a case of congenital short femur syndrome and you can see develop posterior lateral subluxation. So I applied fixator, I distracted it and then reduced it. The next complication is axial deviation. As I told you, the dominant muscle groups develop more tension and they contract. And that is the reason why we get specific axial deviations. For example, in proximal tibial lengthening, we get more of valgus and procurvatum. So before blaming anything else, please check your frame. Unstable frame leads to axial deviations, improper configuration of wires, less angle between the wires, loss of wire tension, loosening of wires or pins. Please pay attention to that. Please check that and correct those things first and then go for correction of axial lengthening. So you might be under impression that with this technique of lengthening over nail, axial deviation won't be a problem, but that's not true. I got actually many papers, but this is a good paper from CORR. It says that axial deviation, valgus deviation in tibia is very, very common even in lengthening over nail. So how do you treat it? So you can go for differential distraction. If there is valgus, for example, you can distract more on lateral side and less on medial side, or even distract on lateral side, compress on medial side. If deviation is more, you can use hinges and correct the deformity. And of course, as I told you, first check the instability in the frame. Now coming to the big problem of pincite infection. Pincite infection is a very common thing that happens. Almost all Elizaro frames have some amount of pin tract infection. But this problem is very important, especially in this technique of lengthening over nail, because the infection in the pins, chance pins or wires can trickle down into the medullary canal, and it can lead to the disastrous complication of intramedullary infection. So the classification is soft tissue inflammation, soft tissue infection, and bone infection. And depending on the appearance, there are 5 grades: just inflamed pin tract, serous discharge, frank purulent discharge, osteolysis, and ring sequestrum. So depending upon the severity, the pin tract should be treated. Like daily pin care is very, very important thing. Antibiotics, oral, sometimes even systemic, and sometimes I even give a local injection at the site. If there is loosening, then change the wire or pins. And if there is ring sequestrum, you have to debride. So a pin tract should look like this. So when you remove it, it should look like this. There is absolutely no inflammation around, no purulent discharge. So your pin tract should be as clean as that. But sometimes we get such badly infected pin sites, so we should avoid this. There can be osteolysis. The pins become loose and they start throwing pus. So I was pointing to this. So pin tract infection is a very important thing. It should be handled in time, because it can lead to this very bad complication of intramedullary infection. So very rarely intramedullary infection can be secondary to infection of corticotomy. Most of the time it is due to infected pin site. So if you see the literature, incidence of intramedullary infection with the lengthening over nail technique is up to 22%, which is very, very high. So we should take this very seriously and try to avoid intramedullary infection, pin tract infection. So what if there is intramedullary infection? If the infection is very severe, suppose it is throwing pus from the entry site, locking site, even corticotomy site, then it's a bad infection. You will have to remove the nail, do thorough debridement. And then there are two options. First option is convert it into pure Elizaro. Apply 1 or 2 more rings and convert it into pure Elizaro. And then treat it as almost like an infected non-union. If you're lucky, your infection will be reduced and you might even get good regenerate at the lengthened site. But if you're not lucky, then you might have to go back, compress, lose the length, and try to unite the fracture. So it's a bad complication. And the second option is you remove the nail, you thoroughly debride the intramedullary canal and insert an antibiotic impregnated cement nail. If infection subsides well and good, then you can reinsert the interlocking nail. Sometimes actually with this technique, you can get infection even after fixator removal. So that has happened with me also. So if you're lucky, if the infection is mild, you debride it, keep antibiotic beads, start oral antibiotics, and wait. If the infection is mild, you might get a good regenerate if the infection is controlled. But if the infection is severe, then again, we are at square one, as I have already told you, treat it as infected non-union, remove the nail, debride, insert an antibiotic nail, reapply the fixator and all. So to cut the long story short, intramedullary infection is a very, very bad complication. Utmost care has to be taken to avoid that in this technique of lingering over nail. So pin tract infections should be treated aggressively and treated early. Proper pin site care should be taught to the patient. Then there are other complications like premature consolidation. Actually, premature consolidation is more commonly failure of incomplete corticotomy. So what you can do is you can, if there is one or two small bridges across the corticotomy site, then you continue distraction till that cortical bridge breaks. The only thing is that you have to warn the patient that there might be a sudden severe sharp shooting pain. And there might be a little diastasis after that, which you will have to compress. But if it is more than one or two strands of bone, then take the patient in OT and do osteoclasts, rotational osteoclasts, or sometimes even recorticotomy has to be done. So more than premature consolidation, delayed consolidation is a big problem. It's a big headache. So there can be technical factors like traumatic corticotomy, as I already told you, initial diastasis of more than 2 millimeters, instability in the frame, and even too rapid distraction can cause delayed consolidation. Then there are patient factors like pre-existing infection, ischemic bone, malnutrition, metabolic factors, and of course, smoking. We should strictly prohibit smoking during limb lengthening. So this is one of my cases. She had to do 5 centimeters lengthening, but she did 6.5 centimeters and she did it too rapidly. So I had to compress her back, and you can see 9 months after removal of fixator, she got this regenerate. So it was a delayed consolidation because too rapid distraction. If you increase the rhythm of distraction, you get very good regenerate. So we divide 1 millimeter into 4 fractions. So 1/4 millimeter, 4 times a day. But if you divide 1 millimeter in 27 fractions, it is called as increasing the rhythm of distraction. If you do that, it's a very, very good technique. You can do it with auto distractors. So this is a lengthening over nail with the Orthofix. And we have developed this auto distractor in our institute. It divides 1 millimeter into 27 fractions. So you can see the regenerate is absolutely fantastic with good results. Now, last but not the least, pain. So post-operative pain is usually there, which subsides within few days, but the pain can continue if there is muscle transfixation, if there is nerve entrapment. Skin tenting also can cause severe pain. And rarely even compartment syndrome can cause pain. So you should take care of all these things. Some dull aching chronic pain is common during distraction phase because of stretching of muscles and nerves. And usually the patient complains that the pain is more in the night and during physiotherapy and walking. So I always feel that pain can be reduced to minimum by proper technique. So avoid thermal necrosis, avoid muscle transfixion and skin tenting. Stable frame is always less painful. So make your frame very stable and treat pin tract problems timely and radically. But of course, you might have to give medication like opiates, acetaminophen, sleeping medication if necessary. And the most important part of limb lengthening is counseling. Patient counseling to the patient so that the patient can tolerate pain or tolerate the procedure better. So thank you for your kind attention. If there are any questions, I can take them.
Thank you, ma'am, for such a nice and elaborative lecture.
Thank you.
Is auto distractor available to you now?
Actually, it is not available still commercially.
Okay.
So, is there any question from the panel?
Fixed to the, you have shown it to the uni planar fixator.
Yeah.
Is it available for the Elizaro also?
Yes, actually on the orthofix, you can get away only with one auto destructor. On Elizaro, you have to fix three.
Ma'am, my question is to you, to Dr. Rajat, or to other senior faculty also. In lengthening over nail in tibia, what you prefer, rail fixator or the Elizarov? Because in our Indian setup, we usually don't do precise nails that much because of the cost factors and all that. Most commonly, we use the nail over there and use the external fixator along with that. Either the rail or the Elizarov.
Of course.
So, see, what you prefer?
Yeah, in tibia, I prefer Elizarov. It's way easier to put on Elizarov in tibia. In femur, actually, it's easier to put on orthofix. But in tibia, definitely Elizarov.
Vasu sir? Same?
Unmute, sir.
Yeah, agreed. Same.
Same, Elizarov.
Yeah.
No, the problem is you have to catch both fibula and tibia.
Okay.
So with the Elizarov, it's easy.
Because in literature, it has been suggested that chances of intramedullary infection are much more if your rail fixator pins are touching the nail.
Yeah.
So,
Absolutely. That can happen in femur, as I showed you.
Yeah,
Chances are way more in femur. But in tibia, actually, you can basically use wires. If you don't want to use transmitter, you can get away with wires, one thing. And it's easier to avoid the nail in tibia, proximal tibia. Okay. So you can put your transmitter away from the nail.
In children, usually the lengthening over nail is usually avoided because of the growth plate, proximal growth plates and all that.
Yeah.
So up to what age you avoid this? At what age you start, you can consider the lengthening over nail in adolescent or at what age?
So you might be aware that I prefer to do lengthening over plate. I started this technique of using plate because of this disastrous complication of intramedullary infection, especially in femur.
Okay.
So in children, I use plate. Only in adults, I go for lengthening over nail.
Okay.
That's my protocol, yeah.
Vasu sir, what's your take on this? In children,
try to avoid nail and lengthening on nail.
Okay. At what age, sir, you consider in adolescent or 18, 14, at what age?
This is mostly in cosmetic length.
Yeah, definitely, sir. Definitely.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have one.
That generally, I don't recommend cosmetic lengthening.
Yeah.
Until they feel it's a disease for them.
Yeah, definitely. That's a different.
I want to comment on cosmetic lengthening, actually. Cosmetic lengthening, I feel, should be discouraged. As Elizarov surgeons, we have in India so many other problems to handle, so many deformities, infections, non-unions, and all those things. We should save our energy for those things rather than cosmetic lengthening. It's not a recommended surgery. All over the world, it's going slowly down. And basically, even in achondroplasics, in America, there is a very, very strong society for little people.
Yeah.
So they are opposing this lengthening procedures, even in achondroplasics and pseudoachondroplasics.
Yeah, there are issues with their societies also.
Yes, they say that you give us facilities as little children. Instead of trying to lengthen or increase our height, you provide us facilities.
There is a group of dwarfs that consider that we don't think that we are basically short, or it's not a psychological disease to us. So exactly. Why you want to treat us like a patient?
So an advice to young orthopods that try to avoid cosmetic lengthening, at least at the beginning of your career. It has a lot of complications also and a lot of ethical issues also. So that's my advice for young orthopods who are.
We have Mangal sir here.
Mangal sir, your take, sir.
Hi, Mangal.
Mangal sir.
Hi. I just joined, so I don't have the context.
Sir, we were discussing of on, cosmetic lengthening, sir.
Your take on cosmetic lengthening, especially in our English setup.
Don't do it.
And if the patient insists?
I do it. I do it in a very, very limited number of cases. But it's not for anyone who doesn't want to get into trouble. Shouldn't be doing it. Just not worth the trouble. Risks are too many. So I'm pretty, what do you call it, selective about the cases that I will take up.
Yeah.
Patient has to be.
Agreed.
And we had a very big problem about a few years back in Hyderabad, and everybody might be knowing that.
Yeah, sir.
Cosmetic lengthening and
all. The IT professional went into the Banjara hospital somewhere. Yeah. There was Times of India article on that.
Yes.
Member,
didn't inform his
so
parents.
Our message to our junior colleagues is that please don't start your Elizaro career with cosmetic lengthening.
Ma'am, with respect to the complications, how often have you seen the peroneal nerve neuropraxia in your tibial lengthening, especially long tibial lengthenings?
I have seen quite often, actually, more than we can anticipate. Yeah.
So, do you consider in long lengthening decompression or primarily?
No, not as a primary measure, but only in very long lengthenings. If patient develops some hyperesthesia, I then decompress them.
As a secondary procedure for the treatment.
Okay. Not as a prophylactic procedure, never.
Okay.
I wanted to share one complication. May I, sir?
Okay. Yeah, please, Jan, sir.
Yeah, initial cases of lengthening over nail, I used a wire with a pin in distally. And while distracting, the pin got entangled in the locking hole of the nail. Now, the nail was not moving. So this was a rare complication. My mistake that I put a nail which was longer and the pin was placed very close to the locking bolt. After that, I've started using a nail which is 5 centimeters shorter than the ankle.
Thank you. Sir, in continuation with your same complication, so what size you consider? Is it the same size that we do the trauma nails in trauma basically, or some sort of
Literature, the literature mentions to use the exact size, but I use 1 mm smaller nail as compared to the trauma one.
Because there is a literature also that suggests that you should use the small diameter nails.
Yeah.
But along with the small diameter nail, there is a complication of bending, breakage.
Yeah, but after you have removed the assembly, then there are problem of this thing, consolidation getting delayed.
The consolidation issue there is.
Yeah. So 1 mm shorter than smaller than what is the normal reaming?
We usually consider for the trauma patients.
Yeah,
the trauma patients we consider as 0.5 mm larger than the size selected.
Size selected.
If it is 10, we ream up to 10.5 and then insert a 10 nail. But here you select 1 mm larger and then do the.
Hello, Dr. Altaf.
1 mm smaller.
Hello,
Altaf sir. You're
hello,
Altaf.
Yeah,
sir.
I have to
I
make.
Want to... Yeah.
Yeah, please, ma'am.
Okay, just I wanted to point out that Dr. Jans said ki he uses nail 5 centimeters shorter than, ankle. So 5 centimeters is a bit too much. Actually, you don't have to use that shorter nail because otherwise the nail becomes too short. Anyway,
you mean 5 mm, it seems.
5 mm, I think. Dr. Jain, you were saying 5 mm, na?
Is it 5 mm or 5 centimeters?
5 centimeters.
5 centimeters. Okay, then
that's what. So 5 centimeters is it? No, you don't have to. You can just go for 5 mm or maximum 1 centimeter because anyway your ring is going to move away from the nail. So in long lengthening, especially if you already use a short nail, it becomes too short. So 5 centimeters is not necessary. Just 1 centimeter is fine enough.
Ma'am, Dr. Shamsul has one question. Dr. Shamsul?
I want to have a word.
Yeah, Dr.
Altaf, before that, Shamsul has to go somewhere. He has one question.
Dr. Shamsul, please.
Excuse him after that.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ravi. Ma'am, just have to ask this question to all the faculty in lengthening or nail in adult femur and tibia. After lengthening over Elizaro, do you just remove the ring and lock just after completion of lengthening or wait for some consolidation?
Wait for?
consolidation. No,
okay.
Dr. Samsul, your sound is breaking actually.
Okay.
Okay, you mean to say immediately after distraction you remove it or wait for some time?
Yes, sir. Exactly. That's the question.
Yeah. So, my protocol and what literature says is you can remove it immediately. You can, I do that. I remove it. I lock it and remove it.
I mean, continuation with the what Samsul is saying, my question is also like that. Because in early removal, if the it is not consolidated, then there are chances of nail breakage and nail bending. Is it advisable to remove at the same just after the lengthening, or should we wait for some time?
If you are in doubt, or if you don't see the region rate at all, or if your corticotomy is traumatic, if you are in doubt, you can always wait. But if all these parameters are good enough, you can immediately lock and remove it, but don't allow full wet bearing immediately. Otherwise, you can.
I give a PTB after your guarded wet bearing. I give a PTB after wait. Removal of.
Prasad sir, you having comment?
It's a unilateral lengthening. Then you can allow partial weight bearing with the walker.
Definitely.
But if it is cosmetic bilateral lengthening, it is more difficult to allow such type of weight bearing, and so you have to protect it for some more time, with either PTB or remove the distraction rods and then put a regular rods and then allow them to weight bear for some time till you feel that the regenerate is capable of maintaining your nail for a regenerate to occur. So that is my suggestion. If it is unilateral, you can go for that, about 25% weight loading. If it is a bilateral, you have to wait for a little longer time.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Altaf, sir, please.
Yeah. I want to make few points. Like I heard the discussion nicely. It was a wonderful discussion. So my take for the and my advice for the beginners is that we try to use a smaller nail to begin with, because more of the problems are because of the premature consolidation.
Yeah.
And what happens that if you use the big nail, I've seen that initial distraction becomes very difficult. Sometimes the distraction doesn't happen at the corticotomy level. So a smaller nail is always helpful in that. Second thing, like Dr. Ruta said, I also prefer ring for the tibia. And because it's very easy to manage, no issues, and then you have always actual loading benefits rather than the uniplanar one. And third thing, the problems of if you use only wires, I've seen many a times the wires are that they don't generate that much power as a shunt spin and odd shunt spin along with the wires. So I always try to have some shunt spins in between so that it has a sound hold on the distracting fragments. Otherwise, simple wires, I've seen that they don't generate that much power because you already have nail within. So you need to have some kind of a force to distract it. Third point, to avoid this, Dr. Jayant said, it's a real practical problem. It does happen many a times that if you have put in the shunt spin and then it can entangle in the screw hole. It's quite possible. So we try to always try to do cortex to cortex pins. One is that you always have this shunt spins distal to the nail. That's no issue. You can manage in any way. But if you have to use in the middle ring where you have the nail, so you try to always try to have a couple of pins which go from cortex to cortex, maybe anterior cortex or the posterior cortex as it allows. So I think that's very helpful.
Thank you, sir. You have really summarized well all the points.
But Dr. Altaf, I think it's better to avoid shunt spins and tibia in the middle ring.
I see. I understand that. In fact, when I started many years back, so I would even put in the middle one as the dummy ring only. I wouldn't put, but But what I found that if you had only fixation too far away from the proximal tibia and you had one in the distal ring, distal tibia, that the force generated was really not that great. And initially, you would have had issues with these. Now you wouldn't, the corticotomy usually wouldn't open up. So even if you have a couple of pins, a couple of these shunt spins in between and which are away from the nail, I don't think there's an issue. And one important thing is that why don't we have problems, like you said, that peroneal nerve palsies. I didn't experience many. Perhaps only one good thing about us here is that our patients follow very regularly. Like you people, somebody who gets lengthening in Mumbai, he'll be coming from far from district and then they usually have difficulties in coming for the regular follow-ups. But I see once people come regularly, follow-ups, maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 week, and then you get to know that your distraction is fast, slow, so you monitor it. I think that's an important issue to prevent these neuropraxias.
Yeah, it's okay. Very
important. Maybe you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. During distraction phase, at least the follow-up should be very, very regular.
Yeah, because I say initially people used to get lengthenings done somewhere far away from different states. And then almost they would have forgotten the patient. And then they would come with all sorts of complications, the regenerates and the all kinds of valguses and these contractures of the tendonoachilles, all those things. Because I think most of the work, like I have been always stressing, in case of Lizaro is before and after the surgical procedure.
Okay. And move on to the case presentation by Vasudev.
Yeah, by that time, Milind sir is joining.
So one question I was having.
We can discuss. Yeah.
Can I ask a question?
Prashant, please ask.
Ma'am, you have described one technique for knee contracture. You have applied a plaster with the pins.
Yeah.
Explain that. I've not got how you apply the plaster on the pins.
See, I showed you that slide, no? So, two rods, threaded rods anteriorly, two threaded rods posteriorly, incorporate those rods in the plaster, and on that rods, I attach rings.
Okay.
And
okay, non-invasive plaster technique.
Correct.
Yeah. Dr. Nuta, may I add one word?
Works very well, actually. You know?
Yeah.
Issues of plaster sore with that?
Sorry?
Are there any issues of plaster sore at the edges?
I told you. So that's the only problem. The plaster can slip up or down. So you have to keep the patient under your observation. If that happens, you have to, you know, change it. So, but it beats the operative technique, you know, it's very easy. And for few 15, 20 degrees of contracture, it really works well.
Dr. Ruta, let me share my experience, with you. Many, many years back, do you know, we did the same technique for creating wedging in, like you have fractures in tibia. And while you would like to do wedging, we did wedging by distraction.
Achha.
Distraction of the plaster, you got my point. Like you cut the plaster at the level of the fracture and then couple of rings in the plaster. It was an easy job.
Correct.
So then corrected it gradually.
Perfect. You know, my residents call it Plastero Zaro.
Vasudevan, sir, can you start your screen share, sir?
Oh, it's mine.
Yeah, sir, yeah. Please. Actually, by that time Milind sir is joining, we can start discussion.
Hello.
With one case discussion and followed by that lecture.
Has he joined? Dr. Milind has joined?
Not yet, ma'am.
Not yet.
Good evening.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So lengthening over nail in tibia. Cosmetic lengthening, so all the details has been already covered. So don't forget to take a full length x-ray. I always do a malignant test. If there is any deformity, correct it. You plan it there. And do not take care that do not create a new deformity. Lengthening on nail has an advantage of maintaining the alignment and lesser fixated time with an added complication of nailing and prolonged surgical time. So this patient, so I didn't get his full length x-ray. I took the x-ray of the limb. And what we do is, first I pass a guide wire in. As soon as the guide wire is in, this is my technique, I osteotomize it. And only after osteotomy, I gently ream it. Maybe if I am reaming, if it is easily going for 11 ream, 11 mm, then I take only 9 size nail, 2 size smaller. If I am reaming 10, then I use 8 size nail. So 2 mm, I usually keep a space. And always I try to get the full length nail just to get two wires in the distal end of the tibia. And I do the proximal locks. Normally I like three screws, then remove the jig and plan for a three ring frame, the uppermost ring at the fibular head, the distal one about 2 centimeters above the ankle joint, the middle one as a dummy ring. So my wires are the proximal reference wire and distal reference wire, proximal fibular wire and distal fibular wire, and medial face wires. Generally, I don't put any olive wires and all. So usually that's enough. I don't like pins here, but then I have nothing against a pin. So you can see the three pins on the top. Three pin distal, you can see the nail tip down there, fibular osteotomy and the tibia. Here you can see the right side, little bit of comminution there, a big butterfly there, but that won't create any problem. So this is lengthening happening on that 23rd day, both sides. This is for the 60th day. The distraction is on the progress. And this is on 70th day. So I got about 68 mm lengthening. My target was 65. So I got that much and I locked the distal side and removed the frame. And he started walking with the walker. So he after about 2 weeks of distal locking, I think within 1 week or something, he left the place. He is far away from my place. So he used to send only the images by X-ray, by email. So this was his 10th month post-operative. This was his gait. You can see that elongated tibia. So this is another boy. He wanted to marry a girl with a little more height than him. So this guy is an Afghan guy. He came from Dubai. So he looks very muscular. So he wanted length. So I described him many times. But through one of my friend in Dubai, he came to me. So I did a tibial lengthening on a nail. So I could not collect this that old images. Now you can see how he is walking with the. So this is very important that he must walk well. And as Rudha said, I kept a ankle in the, you can see a support there on the footwear. And this is the physiotherapy is very, very important in such cases. So, and again, tendo-Achilles is the most important enemy of tibial lengthening. So you must always do the proper stretching exercises for that. And you can see after getting back the length about nearly 7 centimeters, I've locked these distal screws. So he's working on that. I don't put any POP on it. He's working on the walker. So after about a week, he went back to Dubai and this is how he was working there. So this is his final X-ray. It's fully consolidated all over. You cannot even find out the lengthened area. He is a bodybuilder. He went for that. And that was the X-ray just before removal of the frame. You can see he is cycling. and this after implant removal. Thank you. I think if you can you see this?
No, your last video didn't work, sir, actually.
Yeah. Can you see this one now?
Yeah, it's visible, sir. Thanks. Written.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Questions and comments, sir.
Are there any questions from the panel? Altaf, sir. Prasad, sir.
Wonderful presentation, Dr. Vasu, as usual. It's a nice one. So I want to say one comment. I just remembered that for the beginners, how would they lock it? So the natural tendency would be that you remove the frame or a fixator and then lock. Am I right?
I lock it and remove it.
I mean to say, sir, for a junior, yes. What I want you to just have a practical tip. Like once you intend to remove the fixator,
yeah,
first lock within the fixator, because otherwise you will lose all the legs.
And then remove it. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Because that's why I wanted to convey to my juniors that this should be the track. Otherwise, sometimes the tendency would be that you go on, take it off, and then lock it. You would have already undone what you did it for many months together. That was just a point. Otherwise, it's a wonderful presentation. It's just a point I forgot earlier. That's why I tried to make a point now.
Thanks, Vasu, sir. So now we can move ahead to Milind, sir, for his lecture. Milind, sir, please. Sir, please unmute yourself.
Okay. Gentlemen, good evening. I'm so sorry I'm late. A big hello to all of you, big bosses, firstly the ma'am, Ruta ma'am, Ravi, and
thank you, sir.
Boss PN. I'm really sorry. I thought this presentation was tomorrow. So, you know, it's not to be perfectly honest with you.
No, we can understand your busy schedule, sir. It's okay.
No, in the sense, I was a little bit, so these days I find tibia lengthening a little over a nail, not so very interesting. So, you know, because there is less scope of doing deformity correction and a lot of other things in tibia lengthening over nails. So, you know, I started tibia lengthening over nails in 1994, basically lengthening over nails in 1994. And this was written up in IJO in 2008. And now we have done probably several hundred now. But I don't find tibia lengthening that interesting because we can't do much deformity correction. Because of the way unless and until you use a suprapatellar portal, the deformity correction becomes, you know, very difficult or less accurate. And so, you know, I'll, you know, show you some things that I like. So this is one of the things is polio. This young girl came to us with flail and unstable ankle and some shortening. So instead of just, doing this and that lengthening, we did a double level fixator assisted nailing in which we have done an ankle subtalar fusion for her in mild amount of equinus and a distal tibial lengthening over the nail, which was locked in, you know, at the end of the lengthening, and the fixator came out really soon in 1.5 months. Here she is. Here's the, you know, the way she's able to walk. And this is her, you know, the fusion as well as the lengthening and nice hardening of the bone. So that's a little interesting. I've done several of these ankle subtalar fusion combined with tibia lengthening. And the earliest one I think I did was in 2007. Or 2006, I suppose. And, I find tibia lengthening most rewarding in poliomyelitis. You know, I'm sorry, I missed the rest of the and actually nobody seems to be, you know, visible now. So I don't know if anybody's tuning in. So I find it's very interesting to do it in polio because the lengthening in polio takes really too long. And frequently in the femur is very narrow. So there are issues about, you know, not being able to pass in a nail, etc. So I find, so this gentleman is, I didn't realize he's a big shot, he's a president of Heidelberg Cementi, Western Africa, it's poliomyelitis. And, you know, he has some shortening. So he came for lengthening because time is at a premium. So we did lengthening over a nail in the tibia. So watch here. I think what's important is the role of the polar screws. So you don't allow the thing to go into procarvatal. So I see a lot of x-rays here and there. I see people doing lengthening and I made these mistakes myself. You don't use polar screws. It goes into procarvatal because the nail migrates. It wants to migrate posteriorly. Okay. So you need to have a posterior polar screw. Plus you need to have polar screws in the anteroposterior direction to prevent varus and valgus. So here it is. You can see the three polars. You do the lengthening and then it comes off rather quickly. And, you know, this gentleman just needed a little bit of equinus correction also. So we did it, you know, with this, you know, the moment arm vector method and corrected him. And, you know, this is his, so he's in a cast and he went back home and he did well thereafter. So this is my early experience, tibia lengthening over nail. So as I was saying, I'm really interested in femur lengthening because we can do a lot of deformity correction, all kinds of procarvatum correction, recurvatum correction, varus, valgus correction, rotational correction and nailing, double level nailing. We've done, you know, double level lengthening over a nail, one level osteotomy for deformity correction, one level lengthening. So many things in the femur. It's very exciting. There are a lot of things you can do. In the tibia, not so much, I think. So very early in my career, this is a chondrometaphyseal dysplasia. He has got dwarfism. He's syndromic and is very short. And we just lengthened him, you know, using the tibia lengthening over nail method very early in my experience. One side did really well and the other side, see what happened. The entry point is lateral. So he went into varus. He got good 9 centimeters length and all that. But he went into varus. So I had to remove the nail. You know, do the TSF. I've been doing the TSF since 2002 and I had to correct him with the TSF fixator. Not a problem. It was very easy correction. He did well. This is after his correction and both his, he's doing well now. He works in a bank and all that. He's 4'10". His chondrometaphyseal dysplasia. Otherwise, he'd be 4'2" or 4'4" like that. So this is the first one I did. This is a young medical student from, you know, somewhere in the east. He has got some equinus. He's got a fixed flexion deformity, unstable ankle. And he's got this. So this is the first time I did double level lengthening in the femur. Supracondylar osteotomy. It was locked in the nail and lengthened proximally a little bit. And distally in the tibia, you know, same thing again. This is ankle subtalar fusion in mild equinus and lengthening of 6 centimeters. The fixator came off quite soon. And here he is, the nailing in the femur and the nailing in the tibia with the lengthening and the ankle fusion. So the gait is much better. And, you know, he's, so few instances in which I have done, this is a girl with very severe genu valgum in the tibia. I've done some children from lots of places, didn't get the time to gather all the old x-rays. So this is her tibial deformity. So what we've done here is, you know, we've tried to take a little care over the entry point. And here is an LRS fixator. And you see the polar screws, there are lots of polars. There are 3 polars I have used. 4. 2 in the mediolateral, 2 in the anteroposterior direction to prevent the nail. Actually, 5 polars. No, 4 polars. There's one in the distal fragment. It prevents the nail from abutting on the lateral cortex. And if the nail goes laterally, you know, it will go into valgus. So to prevent that, and she got lengthening. She did well. The opposite side, she had a fixator. So we had done her femur, you know, lengthening and deformity correction, double level also. Single level correction and lengthening in the tibia here like this. You can see there's no deformity happening. So the polar screws is really crucial. I've done my bit of aesthetic lengthening. This is an ophthalmic surgeon, also from far away. And I'm not terribly, terribly proud of all this stuff. And I don't encourage it much. And I don't pursue these. I find these people difficult to deal with. They're taxing on my, you know, I don't much like to entertain these people. I think there's something a little wrong with them. And my philosophy from the very beginning is that one should do limited lengthening, if at all, and have limited number of select patients. She seemed to have some very good reason. You know, I have undone lengthening done by people in India and outside also, corrected deformities. It's a lot of problem, cosmetic lengthening, but maybe some intelligent people, deserving people sometimes, but not very, I'm not particularly fond of. So there's one more present, a couple of more slides I wanted to show you just, I hope I can, you know, I'm wondering if anybody is listening or watching this.
Yes, sir, everybody's talking.
Sir, we all everybody are... is falling, falling, yeah, sir.
Okay. So here, you know, this lady, I can't see because of this. Yeah, so this is another, this is not going to run. So she has this school teacher with polio, dramatic instability in her foot ankle, with very bad instability. And you can see the scanogram showing shortening. So this is interesting to do, you know, I think. Again, ankle subtalar fusion and distal tibia lengthening. Fixator comes out really quickly. See how she's walking, got this outrigger and the rays on the other side. And you know, 4-5 weeks, 6 weeks, the fixator comes off. And here she is, you know, not sure whether the, but she's dramatically better. And the equinus, little bit of equinus in polio helps in correcting the, you know, the knee instability as well. And the only other thing that I've learned to do is, you know, when you are fusing in poliomyelitis, the ankle fusion, you need to take a posterior approach. Because if you take an anterior approach for ankle fusion, you're going to resect more bone anteriorly. You're going to end up with dorsiflexion. They're going to be utterly miserable, especially if they have cordyceps weakness. So you better fuse them in equinus. But if you are fusing a normal person, as in after an infected non-union lower end of tibia, post-traumatic or a normal person with normal musculature, you need to go into a little bit of dorsiflexion. Here, of course, the thing that you can't do very nicely is posteriorly translate the distal fragment, which is very helpful in ankle fusion. So, you know, when you can, when you're forced, your hand is forced by infected non-union, infected scenario to use the Elizaro, I have very nicely posteriorly translated. It's very helpful for the patient. Helps them to vault over the long stiff foot. But under the circumstances, this works well. And, you know, she's very happy. So this is one of the very early cases, you know, one of the rare cases, a lot of shortening. Lot of shortening and equinus. This boy with polio. We did this with a humerus nail. So because they have a lesser Herzog curve, the humerus nail works well in most of these polio patients. And nothing special, but he got a lot of length. When we finished, there's nothing going on. There's no bone here. But he had no need for bone grafting and other things. I've done it only once. The very first case I did in 1994, I had to purchase a Russell Taylor nail. Interlocking nailing was not common. So, you know, you either had to, you know, I had to get it from Smith & Nephew, Mumbai and all that. So this is also, I think, 1996 or something. So this is interesting. So he did really well. I've seen him after many years. I've done many in polio. I think that's interesting. And whenever possible, deformity correction. The thing is, it's, I think, unless and until you have a very good suprapatellar portal and you use a lot of polar screws and take a lot of care, I think it always ends up, if you're doing for a normal person, one leg is short, you can do well. But the tendency for valgus and procarvatum in tibial lengthening is there. And the second thing I want to warn you about is the migration of the fibula. You watch for migration in the fibula. You show x-rays without showing the ankle. Show the ankle and see what's happening to the fibula. Until and unless I started working in JLLR, I was not very aware, because now I have to read very carefully. And even 2-3 millimeters of proximal migration of the fibula, I have done many cases. You have to bring them down and it causes a lot of disability in the ankle. So, you know, as I said again, I really enjoy lengthening femur because you can do a lot of corrections. You know, it's very challenging and interesting, not so much in the tibia, but it has its role. I think more in, I'm not very, very fond of cosmetic lengthening. I'm fed up of having to deal with these people and their shenanigans. I very much prefer treating simple folks with regular day-to-day problems. And I thank you very much for your kind invitation. Professor Ruta Kulkarni, ma'am, and our secretary and Jayan, thank you so much for your kind invitation. I hope I've added something of value. I'll be happy to answer any queries.
Thank you, sir, for sharing such a nice presentation and nice cases.
Sir, we cannot afford to miss your talk, sir. You are thinking that anybody is listening or not, but we cannot afford to miss your talk.
Hi, Prasad. I'm so sorry I'm late. Such a pleasure seeing you.
Now the panel is free to ask any question with Milind sir.
Vasu sir.
Yeah, it was good. Great, Milind, as usual.
Thank you, Vasu.
Yeah.
Altaf, sir.
Nice presentation, sir. Not much to be in. I don't think we need to ask you anything. You have a wonderful collection and for last 30 years you have been doing it, and who can know better than you for limb lengthening or nail. So any real difficulties which you found, Dr. Milind?
Yeah, so, you know, in the standard portal for tibia lengthening, when we really have to hyperflex the knee to get the entry, firstly, you have to get the entry very proximal. And you have to pass the polar screw a little away from the posterior cortex. You use the polar screw, mediolateral polar screw, to avoid the nail from going towards the posterior cortex. That's a must. You have to use 2-3 polar screws to really direct the nail, because otherwise, when you hyperflex the knee and the nail goes in, you know, the presence of the patella, you know, you just little bit mistake, you shift here and there, the entry point shifts, you know. It's very difficult. Yeah. And whereas we can have far better control in the, and so now with the suprapatellar devices being available, I think it may be possible. So these are the issues. And, you know, suppose, for example, you're doing equinus correction in polio. So, you know, it's a real conundrum. What do you correct first? Do you fix the distal fibula? Because if you fix the distal fibula, then you can't correct the equinus. Okay, so if you're doing lengthening over a nail, or if you're doing tibia lengthening and equinus correction, which sometimes happens in practice. And so if you're correcting the equinus, the broad part of the talus, which is anterior, has to come into the mortise. And for that, you can't fix the fibula. It has to spring open. But if you're doing lengthening at the same time, then the fibula will migrate. So these are some of the interesting conundrums, you know. So
one thing, Dr. Milind, I would like to discuss here is that in case of smaller lengthenings, maybe 5 centimeters, and then, you know, a lot of technicalities involved in the lengthening one nail. So if we weigh the risks and benefits vis-a-vis lengthening one nail with a ring or with a hybrid ring with it, and while on the other side you have a lengthening or simple lateral lengthening. So wouldn't it be a point that if you have, for the beginners or some who don't have much of a volume of lengthenings, so would you not prefer that people continue with the conventional lengthening or smaller lengthenings? Because we have to ultimately find that if you have lot many technicalities involved, lot of polar screws, lot of operating time, intra-op observation, intra-op monitoring, so what would be your take for smaller lengthenings?
Yeah, that's a pretty valid point. But see, today what's happening, Altaf, you have also been doing lengthening for a really long time. And you remember, like Vasu and Altaf and Prasad, all of you, we have been doing lengthening for many years. I think the patient demographic has changed these days, you know. So let's take, actually, I'm so sorry, I have very many interesting cases. So like CPMBT, you know, they present after adulthood, you know, congenital posteromedial bowing. Mm-hmm. They're told to wait until maturity. they've got 5 centimeter shortening, 5.5. Okay. And they're, you know, they're big, they're bulky, there's some congenital shortening. So I've done a lot of tibial nailings in these people. Sorry, didn't gather more interesting photos. What happens when they're 20, 22, 24, they're just entering employment or other transitional phases of life. And if you're going to do a lengthening or a fixator, you know, by now they become obese. They're not, you know, very, I'm not talking cosmetic lengthenings. I'm talking of guys who have congenital shortening, unilateral shortening. Okay. Because they've had this handicap, they're not very, you know, athletic, agile, you know, and they will not walk 3-4 hours a day, what I tell them to. And they will take a long time to harden the regenerate. And in
Dr. Millen, I have absolutely no confusion. It's a wonderful, wonderful technique. And I would rather these days I do transport over nail even. So it's a wonderful technique. You get rid of the rings very fast. But what I'm saying that perhaps the indications for lengthening over nail to begin with should be limited for the persons who have a simple shortening, not many deformities. Till a guy has a good feel about doing, because I think that's quite a difficult one. Like you said to begin with, that with deformities, one would prefer a simple ring fixator rather than a lengthening over nail.
I agree. Absolutely. You're right. Absolutely.
Yeah, Dr. Manish, please go ahead.
Sir, good evening, everybody. Good evening, Milind, sir. Sir, I had a question in general, sir, like lengthening over nails for post-infective sequelae. Sir, do you recommend any proper profile access? Because once there has been some osteomyelitis or something, is it really recommended? If we go ahead with it, after how long should we go ahead? What should be the basic workup and what should be the perioperative management, sir, including long-term measures to be taken, sir? Thank you.
No, I would really resist the temptation to do it. I've really resisted the temptation. I'm very happy. I'll tell you, once I did it in somebody who had an infection several years back and it flared up. It's not a good idea at all. I would never do it in a post-infective patient, however many years may have passed, because even if they have a sclerotic canal, you know, then the bone doesn't form well, and if they get into infection, so I've had about 6 or 7 infected tibia nails, lengthening over a nail, okay? It's not impossible to cure them. You put in a fixator, you know, keep the fixator, remove the nail, put an ABC rod and all that, and they will heal and the bone will also form. But it's too much trouble, and I would really avoid previously infected cases. Absolutely avoid.
And Dr. Manish, you hardly would get a case which is really good enough for this lengthening over nail. So you somebody who had an infection will always have some issues with the canal, some with deformity, whatever. And I don't think anybody would be gutsy enough to do nail in those cases. It's better to avoid in those cases.
Sir, your bone is much more sclerotic and with a very bad marrow actually.
Sir, as Dr. Altaf sir had just mentioned about transport over nails. So what kind of cases do you get, sir? Like mostly
traumatic. Okay. So where you feel that you have an aseptic gap.
Yes, sir.
You see that you don't have any issues. I wouldn't prefer that somebody is coming with an open fracture with a composite defect. I wouldn't prefer in them.
Okay.
Because sometimes you have kind of a fracture gap which is created by a butterfly fragment which has gone over and above. For example, it's a kind of a practical defect rather than actual bone loss. Kind of imagine a fragment in the middle or in distal where you have had the bone which is fragmented into two pieces and they have gone one up, one down. And practically, you have a bone gap. But at the same time, it's an aseptic defect. So you can transport over there in that cases. Not in open fractures. I wouldn't try to do that.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Move on to Prasad sir's case presentation now.
Yeah, sir. Yes. Thank you, Milind sir. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir, Milind.
Thank you very much for the inviting me to the as a faculty to this limb lengthening on nail. Is it visible?
Yeah, Prashant sir, please go ahead.
Limb lengthening using only Elizaro external fixation is safe, but the frame has to be there for the limb till completion of the consolidation phase. The method of lengthening on nail reduces the time spent in external fixation so that it can increase patient comfort and compliance. Interlocking nail is used as described before by the other speakers. Hello.
Prashant sir, your slide is not moving.
That is what I am saying. Why it's not moving?
Yeah, just go down, sir. Just
click once on the slide. And yeah. Then
if you are using Mac, then just click on the touchpad, sir.
Yeah, I'm getting it now. The technique is I'll make a wide hole with a drill at the lower end of the tibia and medial aspect. This is not described before by any of the speakers, and this is a very important step to prevent the risk of ARDS before start of the procedure. So do it first before introduction of any guide wire or anything, because it is a closed compartment. The chance of ARDS are very high in this, because in fractures it's different, but here it is an intact bone. I start like a regular interlock nail with the same entry point. I pass the guide wire and I ream it to the size of 1 mm larger. It's not, as I have told before, not 0.5 mm, but it is 1 mm, and insert the longest nail possible. Not 5 centimeters, but only 5 to 10 millimeters above the what you can say, the lower part of the facial line. And I once pass the nail, I mark the site of Herzog curve after fully inserting the nail. And 1 centimeter below that, I pass the Giglissa subperiosteally, 1 centimeter below the curve, and start cutting the bone after withdrawing the nail slightly above the intended cut. The guide wire, if it were to be there, also to be withdrawn and reinserted after cutting about 50% of the bone. And it should be posterior to the Giglissa. Once the catecotomy is complete, reinsert the nail over the guide wire to the same point and remove the guide wire and lock the nail proximally with 2 screws or 3 screws. Preferably if the design allows you to do it. Distally lock with 1 screw to prevent any rotational abnormality that can occur while applying the frame, which has to be removed at the end of the procedure. Don't forget it. Otherwise, there will be distraction problems like Dr. Jayanth has faced with the Shan's pin. Pass 2 wires above and below, avoiding the nail, which can be done very easily in tibia, and transfixing the fibular head superiorly and lateral malleus inferiorly. Attach the wires to the rings with 3 to 4 telescopic rods, either graduated or simple, whichever is available. Graduated is better, which lock with every step of rotation. Do fibular osteotomy at this point after attaching the rings and remove the distal locking screw. Distraction can be as usual to be started after 5 days with 1/4 mm every 6 hours till the desired length has been achieved. Once it has been reached, lock the nail distally with 2 screws and remove the frame and wait till the consolidation with partial weight bearing in case of unilateral lengthenings, and in case of bilateral lengthenings, I delay some more days by removing the distraction apparatus, but by keeping normal threaded rods connecting the rings. This cannot be used in adolescents as the nail interferes with the growth. A full weight bearing is delayed compared to total frame assembly. If we use a distraction without nail, especially in cosmetic lengthening, a common type of scarring of the pin tracks is visible, as you are seeing in this, like this, and which is not visible in cosmetic lengthening, as most of these cases are cosmetic lengthening cases. Ugly scarring will be there on the legs, and in cosmetic lengthening, it may not be preferred by the patients. The usual complications, Ruta ma'am has described many complications, but the usual complications are hourglass regenerate because of the patient's enthusiastic excessive speed of distraction, because they want to get longer as early as possible. Even though we describe them the exact method of rotation, they do it in excess, and by the time they come by 1 month, they might have distracted more than 3 centimeters of distraction, and that goes with the atrophic type of regenerate, hourglass type of regenerate. So non-union or delayed union because of the above this thing, and sometimes premature union because of inability to get distracted due to a tight nail can also occur. So be careful about this and warn them. And if it is an atrophic or hourglass appearance of regenerate, it's very difficult to get rid of that. I had a case of pin track infection or the infection of the limb. It is not pin track, but the middle part of the limb has become red, swollen, and warm. And so I have to remove that nail, and I'll show you in the next slide. And the other thing is eeciness of the ankle is more common complication and has to be prevented by a screw from the calcaneum to the tibia, a transcalcaneal tibial screw, which Dr. Pelle used to put it, cancellous screw, CC screw, or a guide wire to prevent equinous deformity of the ankle. Or a foot ring is required to prevent equinous deformity. But the best thing is attach a elastic type of splint, so that during night also you should wear, and the equinus should be prevented. The whole night they should wear it, even in the during the daytime when they are not walking, they should wear the elastic type of splint or the rubber band, 1 inch wide rubber band, so that the equinus can be prevented. It is a case of bilateral cosmetic lengthening, which I have done a very few cases. I discourage them as far as possible, as with other speakers, but only in cases of I felt that it is necessary for them, something like that. If they are good at dancing and other things, I'll see them, and then I actually see their videos and their performance, and then do something, do the lengthening afterwards. So this is a case of bilateral lengthening. Cosmetic lengthening was done, and 2 lakhs at the proximally and distracted. And this is the case of infection. The nail has been removed. And while removal, I found some blackish material from the point of entry and screw holes, locking screw holes, which you can see on my hand and gloved hand. And I removed the nail, and that nail has been removed on that side, and right side is getting consolidated with the nail in situ, and two more rings were attached to the additional rings were attached to the on the other side, left side, and that is also getting consolidated. Luckily, I escaped major infection and it got consolidated, and this is the final image, and you can see the range of movement. And good cosmetically acceptable limbs. Thank you.
Thank you, sir,
for sharing such a good case.
Questions, suggestions, opinion of the panels?
Panel is open for discussion. Altaf sir, Vasu sir, any?
Yeah, Dr. V, I want to have a word. Dr. Prasad, wonderful presentation, Dr. Prasad.
Thank you, thanks.
Like you said, that nobody said about that drill hole you made to decompress the canal. But like Dr. Vasu showed, and well, I also do that way, that you put in a guide wire and do the corticotomy. So you have already created a fracture. And after that, once you reem, so you don't have any problems with that. And in fact, perhaps the advantage is that the reamings will come out from the corticotomy site only. And this will perhaps enhance the regenerate. Rather than in your case, if you have a drill hole distally, then the reamings are going to go through that. Perhaps maybe you others agree also. Because now once you have created a corticotomy, that's a fracture. And then it's equivalent to as if fixing a tibial fracture. And then simply once you put in a guide wire, do corticotomy, then reamings, then putting in a nail, and then finally the fixator for the dissection. I don't think there's any bad idea in that. I think maybe others, Dr. Vasu and others, would agree with that.
I think the distal screw hole may get blocked by the clothes. It may not work.
And then if you have a corticotomy already, you have a fracture, then reamings are going to get, And perhaps, and what is wonderful about lengthening your nail is these reamings also. You'll always find a good regenerate. If you have done good corticotomy and then you have the reamings around the corticotomy area, it enhances regenerate. To my experience.
And I generally like to have a middle dummy ring because the long rods that will produce a little more unwanted strain on the regenerate and the nail.
Okay.
And some of the cases, I think, Prasad, it was a nice presentation, but your corticotomy has been on the
shaft. Distal.
And the?
More distal, more diaphyseal.
More on the diaphysis than...
Yeah, little. I have selected a wrong nail. Actually, in this case, a bit Herzog curve is little below, little longer. Right. And so I go 1 centimeter below that. And so the corticotomy has become a little lower.
Yeah.
Little, but still the regenerate occurs.
Yes, I agree with you. I agree. The regenerate...
Because if you take a... corticotomy above the Herzog curve, there is a possibility of shifting of the distal part while coming down.
So when you're doing a corticotomy, maybe in the mid-shaft or around that area, do you change the rate of distraction or rhythm of distraction?
Yeah, if I observe that there is some hourglass appearances with the early...
I'll change that. Do you change? Do you change at the start? Because there's no point in after finding the hourglass regenerate, if you change it now, it may not be very useful.
No, sir. Early streaks of this thing will be seen. When the early streaks can be observed, at that time also we can change. So, but in the beginning, we take regular x-rays rather than taking it 3 months or 2 months. It will be a regular at a 3 week interval. So that you can observe whether it's going for an hourglass appearance or regular cylinder type of regenerate is there or not. So in the early stage, I take regular x-rays. or sometimes I go to the ultrasound unit and then I do the ultrasound and observe whether it is in the hourglass or not. I take that also.
With the nail there?
Yeah, with the nail there, still you will get ultrasound these images.
Thank you, Prashant sir. So now we can move to the last case. Prashant? Dr. Prashant, please share your case.
Sir, is it audible?
Please go ahead.
Sir, I'll be speaking on limb lengthening over nail with ring fixator. We already have discussed a few points. We are well understood by the principle of Elizaro. We all know that distraction phase is mostly well tolerated by patient, but the consolidation phase is a phase which brings a lot of problem for both the patient as well as for the surgeon. So why do we need a nail when we are doing a lengthening procedure? Is to reduce this consolidation phase. This reduces the time spent in the external fixator. So it increases the patient comfort and it also reduces the axial deviation. It was first performed by Bost and Larson in 1956 and then it was popularized by Paleta. All those patients who have a fused epiphyseal plate, we can go for it. Even in pediatric population also, we can go for all those men who have a short limb. And the third point is a little a controversial point in which we can do lengthening as a cosmetic lengthening. I don't support cosmetic lengthening, but for selected cases, for medico-legal points, we need to keep in mind what are the medico-legal points that we need to keep when we are doing a cosmetic lengthening. I just want to say a few points on that, because there are certain points or there are certain rules that are laid by the Medical Council of India. There are four principles of ethics. First is respect for the autonomy of the patient, then beneficence, non-beneficence, and justice. I want to put some light on all these four points. Like respect for autonomy, it implies giving due consideration to the patient's decision. Thus, if a patient of normal stature requests a height gain surgery, the doctor cannot ethically deny this. Denying the request would mean violating the patient's right to autonomy. Beneficence means acting in the patient's best interest. The surgical procedure should be shown to have benefited other patients who have undergone it. Clinical studies have shown that cosmetic limb lengthening surgery not only increases the height of all patients, but also improves the person's self-esteem. Non-maleficence means refraining from doing any harm to the patient. All the surgeries are associated with problems and few complications, but the results should outweigh the problems. Justice, it means taking a decision that would benefit not only the patient, but society as well. So in the private healthcare system, patients pay for healthcare and hence are in a position to choose the type of surgical procedure they wish to undergo. And it is very, very important to take the consent if we are going for cosmetic limb lengthening. As per the Indian law, mature adults above 18 years of age can make independent decisions. Obtaining their parents' consent is not mandatory. It is up to them, to their families, relatives, or friends about any surgical procedure they wish to undergo. Documenting is very, very important. And this, I just want to put a point in this, because most of the patient, they have medical insurance, but any type of cosmetic surgery is not refunded by medical insurance. And this is one of the limiting factors for those who seek cosmetic lengthening. We measure the limb length, normal height is plus or minus 3 standard deviation from the mean. The lower limit in normal stature for Asian population is considered to be 5'2" for males and 4'11" for females. Still, I want to say this point that I don't support cosmetic limb lengthening. But all these points I have added into my slide just to know that what all medical legal points we need to keep in mind if we are going for a cosmetic lending. Now, how we the procedure that we do is we do a normal interlocking nail. I pre-drill the corticotomy site few centimeter below the Herzog's curve. Length from the ankle, we can 5 or even 3 centimeter is fine. 3 centimeters short of ankle, we can keep the length of the nail. We lock the proximal hole. Fibular osteotomy is done at mid-thigh junction, and then external fixator is applied. In the second surgery, after completion of the lengthening, the external fixator is removed and nail is locked distally. Now, this is a case in which I have done a lengthening bilaterally. An interlocking nail was applied, and this nail was applied by leg hanging down. It was applied on a frame, on a wooden frame. Bilateral nail was applied, proximal locking was done. The osteotomy was done through the pre-drill multiple holes. As already being discussed that no separate drilling holes was needed for bending. And also it carries an advantage of dispersing the reaming material in the vicinity of the osteotomy site. The fibular osteotomy, we do this already, we have seen. The point that I want to add in this is that wire tensioning that I have used was suboptimal. It was almost 10 Newton less than the normal, because when we are using a lawn, and to reduce the risk of wire breakage during the distraction, we reduce the wire tensioning. This was the case. The frame was prepared before the operation. The frame was applied. It was a carbon frame. This is when the corticotomy was done just below the Herzog's angle. And this is how it looked like. Patient was allowed to bear weight just after the operation with support. This is after 1 month of distraction. I just want to keep, I just want to show that on the left side of the limb, the distraction is not that that proper. So again, we have to take the patient in the OT to complete the osteotomy. This was after a few months, and this was the length that we were able to achieve. It was almost 8 centimeter of length. The advantage of carbon ring is that it is not visible on X-ray, and also it's it is lightweight. This was after the removal of the fixator, and this I just wanted to show because the patient was not able to keep the limb on the ground when he was sitting on a two-wheeler. After the operation, he was able to. So some of the cases were there in which I was able to achieve almost 7 centimeter of length. This case is still under follow-up. The complication are already being discussed by Ruta ma'am. One of the complication that I have seen in my case is that inability to distract the osteotomy site. So we need to take the patient again for doing the osteotomy. So in conclusion, I would like to say that lengthening over nail is a useful procedure in reducing the duration of the consolidation phase. It enables early weight bearing and better patient compliance. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Prashant. Any question from the panel? So,
yes, Prashant.
Sir.
Is there any rule for the in the medical council to avoid a patient? So they have their own right. Do we have a right to
select
a patient? No, they have their own right. Do we have a right to select our own patient?
Yes, sir. We have that right, sir.
Yes, sir. We have the right to reject.
Refuse. We have right to refuse the treatment. I have also refused few cases of.
If the patient says, "I want you to treat me,"
still you have the right to reject.
So whose right? Our right or patient's right?
Both, sir.
Both,
sir. If you feel in the good faith that nobody is comfortable with doing lengthening, and then if you feel that you can foresee more complications than the patient himself.
Yeah.
So I think you have all the rights and you can always explain. And I don't think anybody in world could be that much confident enough to avoid even a pin track infection.
Yeah, I have done it many times.
Yeah, most of the time, sir. Most of the time. Because, and then for, you see, if you are going to lengthen for cosmetic reasons, and then somebody is lengthening only the tibias. So the tibia and femur, they are always disproportionate. So it still does not, I mean to say, it does not restore the actual proportions for a normal looking cosmesis. For normal cosmesis. If you see somebody has been lengthening both tibia, the tibia from a distance look, from a distance even look disproportionate to the rest of the body. So it's longer, actually not but, that cosmetic.
But longer leg, leg segment than tibia femur is, I think it is more cosmetic.
Now what I mean to say then, it's preferably better, said Dr. Vasu, I think preferably in that is the, it's better like the actual Elizabeth one. That you lengthen one femur and other tibia on other side, and then another femur and opposite tibia. So that restores the actual proportions. This is my take. Because otherwise you see short femurs and long tibia. Despite the overall lengthen being, the patient being lengthened. But still cosmetically he is disproportionate.
Vasu sir.
Yeah.
Vasu sir and Mangal sir, especially our senior faculty. That as we are talking about cosmetic lengthening, then what's your experience about height dysphoria or height neurosis, what we call? How you often deal with these patients?
I didn't get that.
Height dysphoria or height neurosis, what we call about the people who come to you and say that they are tall, they are short as compared to others, the kind of psychological issues.
Psychiatric treatment.
How you often deal with these for limb lengthenings actually?
Refer them there. I had a patient where that guy was from faraway place. He was beating his parents. So he came to me that I can see the torture mark on the parents. Then I just told him, see, now you are, I can see the mark from your on your parent. Now you will do the same to me also. So that such patient, we cannot do that. Because that's actually not, the real issue is something else. So they are blaming everything because of the shortening, they have lost everything in their life. So that is actually not their issue.
Because it's a psychiatric condition also, in psychiatric terms also we call it height dysphoria or height neurosis.
No, but the thing is, if it's a neurosis, actually those are the patients who do the best in lengthening, and I actually those are the kind of patients that I will take on. They are satisfied. They come with a relatively understandable requirement for length. They are happy with 5 and 6 centimeters. They don't want 8 and 10 centimeters.
They are reasonable now. So some patient comes, I want 1 feet.
Yeah. So those are the guys. Those are the guys who are not. But the people who have height dysphoria generally, their mismatch of their their self image and their actual height
definitely
is reasonable. Is 5, 6, 7 centimeters, which is achievable. Number one. Number two, they have to have researched the whole thing. I will explain all the negatives, including death on table, because of embolism, etc., etc., etc. And there has to be a family member who is with them in the consultation who agrees to that. In fact, most of the ones that I have done, they have come with, they've actually been, the younger ones have been brought by the parent, kind of, who has helped them in doing the research and stuff. That kind of patient, I'm quite, safe comfortable in doing. If I can make out any alarms, like what Vasu pointed out, that I feel that tension that mom or dad doesn't want it. Because what will happen is the moment those people start having trouble, and everybody has trouble, I'm not talking of complications of surgery. When they are doing lengthening, they are going to be away from social life. They don't want everyone to know. Now, when you're away and deprived of social interaction, the pain and all that will cause you psychological trouble. And those patients, then when they have to interact with the family and family says, I told you not to do it, etc., etc., then all of that, you know, headache comes on to the doctor. That emotional support, we are there to give medical support. You can't give them emotional support. That's the role of the family. So, yeah. Unless all of these things are there, I'm not interested in...
Yes, you're right, Mangala. If the patient says, I need length of about 5 centimeters or 7 centimeters, so they are all sensible patients.
Yes.
So, yeah. Many a time what happens, you know, they imaginary, some people will come there, I want 1 feet.
Hmm. Yeah, those guys are out and out.
So, those things we must avoid. So, but yeah, I do explain where one medical student bought a friend for tibia lengthening. So, he bought me, his father and the mother all together. They came to me and I have taken it for surgery and operated on him because they all medical students, all friends were there.
Mm.
Third day, his real father and mother came.
Oh.
And they were furious that they want to break, they want to cut the legs of both the, of that patient. The real issue was the neighbor of he was in affair with the nearby girl, next house girl.
Oh.
these were family enemies.
Mm.
But he was in love with that girl. She is equal height. So the parents promised this boy, if your height was 2 inches or at least 1 inch longer, then we would have no issues. So he got that promise and parents were totally unaware.
So finally, Heidi got her or not?
No, they came with all this. I told her it's very easy to cut his leg off now. I already bought and cut his bone. I'll give you the spanner. You just remove these things. His leg will be amputated. You can do it now. Then that both parents went off. So that guy got about nearly 3 inches of length and he got married to that girl.
Oh. And they must be thanking you, sir. So coming back to our normal tibia lengthening over nail, basically...
I have one question to Manish Prasad.
Yes, sir, please.
Manish, do you accept these patients who have got cosmetic lengthening in your RV selections? There were few of the students who were going to appear for the physical exam, this thing, came to me for a cosmetic lengthening operation.
Not at all, sir. It's a clear-cut rejection criteria, sir.
Okay.
But is there any criteria how to identify it?
Sir, you will see...
X-rays or all that?
Yes. They are all laid down procedures. There are SOPs. You will see scars. It cannot be done... Without a scar. And then if there is a single scar, which is an operative scar, you ask for a complete treatment history. Unless and until you have this complete treatment history by the treating physician doctor, you do not proceed any further with it. Even if there are fractures and all, we do not accept them unless a reasonable time frame has gone by. Something like ligament injuries, we do not accept at all because they are fraught with failures over a period of time. They can't take the burden of the stress and strain of training.
Okay.
So many other things like that, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Manish. So,
I have not seen a selection method in the army. I was there as a recruiting officer for CRPF.
Sir.
First thing, they tie a rope and then they will ask them to pass under that. Whoever goes under that, he will be out. The next, they will be standing on a cheddi underwear. And then we go in front of them. One person will be pulling up whatever the scars that is there. And we'll be coming back again from the back side of the those who are standing. And then like this, we will be pulling out. So that is the way it is done. Because a lot of crowd will be there.
Yes,
for 100 recruitments, about 5,000 to 10,000 people will attend.
Absolutely right, sir. They're all crowd control measures and they tie a rope because they'll tie it at a particular height. So you know that a person who's below this height is simply not there.
They will walk home.
So it's
under the rope, they will walk home. That's all.
Yes.
Thank you, thank you. So before conclusion, I would like to take the final basically summary points from Mangal sir, from Vasu sir, our experienced faculty. Mangal sir, any key points for TBL lengthening over nails to youngsters?
No, I think all the points in that sense have been made very well by the presenters. Only warning is that it should be something later. We gave a lot of good advantages of lengthening over a nail. Shortens the fixator time, etc. But at the same time, one must remember that this is somewhere higher up on the learning curve. You have to learn the method of Elizarov first, learn and understand, you know, how the regenerate forms. You have to get a feel of the follow-up of the patients, finding out what troubles occur. And lengthening over a nail comes only after that. It's not that, yeah, these guys said lengthening over a nail and the fixator comes out quicker, so it's easier. Let's do it. No, that's not it. Lengthening over the nail is kind of the next step to improve whatever it is that you are able to do, number one. Number two, younger guys, I would say don't touch cosmetic lengthening. It's not worth the trouble. Leave it to the guys who are, you know, already into it for a few years, because one, especially early on, if you do it, one guy that goes bad, like the case which happened in Hyderabad,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
that,
yeah,
that is that was not because of the surgeon's surgical issues, but the one of the indications for surgery or getting good results is choosing the right patient. And what Upadhyay said about, you know, the beneficence and all of that. So those are very gray areas for cosmetic lengthening. We do it, but very, very particular kind of patients. It's not, we don't do it as a method of earning money. I personally do it because if I don't do it, then this guy may go and get it done somewhere else, have trouble and stuff like that. You know, it's that's my approach at least.
I have a question to all the faculties. How often you put to trend to put the put Polar School like Milin said?
Yeah, so I was coming to the same question, sir, actually.
I have not put, sir.
Like,
I don't.
Having four Polar School on a lengthening on a nail, unless there is some other issues, I don't know.
No, the Polar Screws are only if you are doing a deformity correction like he showed in that girl with the deformity. LRS and all.
Yeah.
There, yes. But for a straight lengthening,
okay. Vasu sir, your last comments?
I've done it now, no?
Altaf sir, do you want to say anything?
My last comment is like Dr. Mangal said, if you have a straighter lengthening, fine enough with the simple lengthening. Only polar screw would be needed if you need to have a deformity. And there, like I discussed with Dr. Milin, we might weigh the benefits and risk if we have to do a lengthening in case of deformity. Why not to do it with the simple fixator only? In such a case, if you are feeling that it's going to be technically very difficult, and if you have only 5 centimeters of lengthening, then preferable lengthening as well as deformity correction, then preferably I would go with the conventional method.
Thank
rather
you,
than having to struggle a lot intraoperative.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Manish, you want to say something?
Sir, I just wanted to ask the esteemed faculty, do we have some Indian version of the precise nails or some kind of those lengthening nails?
No.
So as Assami India, can't we take up this challenge, sir? We all can contribute in whatever way.
We need to collaborate with the ITNs and a lot of stuff.
So one of the aims of our organization just a thought, sir.
Nice thought.
Manish, but I have a biomedical engineering patient at this moment. He's a professor head of in an engineering college, government college.
Sir,
I'll have a word with him.
Yes. I think if I can do anything about it, Dr. Manish,
remind me when the Rawat patient comes next time.
I think Dr. Manish, in coming few years, I think Mangal sir will come with that.
We'll be glad to. We'll be
such a long experience. Basically, he has already done a lot of things.
Because so, it straight away costs 8-10 lakh rupees, and I mean, even in the army, it is difficult to get it. Sir.
Definitely, it's very costly, and that's the basically prime hindrance to our Indian society.
Yes,
basically. Prashad sir, your last comment before conclusion.
No, I am very choosy with these patients. There are people who have threatened me that they will jump off the building and then they will die if I don't do it. Still, I have budged to their threats, and you should be very choosy with your patient, as Mangal said, that you should be very choosy. That's all.
Thank you, sir. So, I'm really thankful for our esteemed faculty for sparing their valuable time. Thanks, Dr. Prashant. Thanks, Dr. Manish, for sparing your valuable time. And in the last, I'm really thankful for all of our audiences, all of our Assami members, and especially our technical team, Dr. Manish Prasad, Samsul Huda, our joint secretary, Dr. Neeraj Bijlani, and Dr. Ashok Shyam, and Supriya on behalf of Dr. Neeraj Bijlani. Thank you, all of you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Good night, sir.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.